I believe that even in our darkest hour, even when we're in the midst of the hardest, most challenging things that can happen to us, somehow we have to be able to reach really, really deep within our internal selves and somehow pull ourselves up, find the courage, find the tools, whatever it takes to rise above that tragedy that's right before us. In August of 1961, I was 6 years old. My mother had put me to bed, and next thing I know, she had come into my bedroom and woke me up. And I snuggled up next to my mom, and I put my arm around her, and she says, "Your father and I have had a fight, and I don't know what to do." For some reason, I knew that my mom needed to lock the front door and not let my stepfather come back in. So I pointed to the door and I said, "Lock the door. Don't let him come back into the house." And we had a conversation, and then she took me back to the bedroom and put me in bed, tucked me in. And then I'm not exactly sure how long it was, maybe an hour or so. I was woken up with a lot of loud noise, and I ran out of my bedroom and into the hallway. And down the hallway, I could see that the apartment door was open, and I could see that my mother was laying there. And I ran past the kitchen, and I heard this noise. I blocked it out, what that was. That was actually my father had taken his life. He put a gun to his head. But my mother was there in the hallway, and she was laying down, and she was just in a pool of blood and was looking up at me. I could see that her eyes were still, you know, she was still alive, but I leaned over and I tried to engage my mom, tried to talk to her. She couldn't talk, and I started, you know, just crying, and it was just that sense of, oh my God, what's happened and what can I do? And yet I knew I couldn't do anything. I'm there, my mother is killed. My stepfather takes his own life in the kitchen. And it was just, it's hard to put into words what that was about that night. I'm in Germany. Within a couple of weeks, I'm shipped back to the United States. Then I get to Montpelier, Idaho, and here's Mrs. Anderson, and I end up doing this watercolor. I can still see it. It was a stagecoach and a sunset, and I get this thing done, and she comes up, and she holds it up to the class. And she says, "Look what Gary Price did." And that feeling was just like, wow, I just did something great. I was in my last year of college at the University of Utah, kind of having a crisis, trying to figure out how can I get through this, seeing the light at the end of the tunnel. I ended up reaching out to another artist, and he happened to be a sculptor. I had never actually sculpted before and worked with clay. I was always, you know, painting and drawing and the figure and that visual, colorful world. This gentleman, through us being together and me literally sleeping in his studio for 9 months, I had a foam pad and I had a Coleman sleeping bag. And every night I'd work with him all day long, weld, I'd do his patinas, all these things on his bronzes. Then at night I'd go up in the studio and I would work with clay and create and do three-dimensional. Instead of just creating an illusion, I was actually creating the object itself. And this was like, oh, this was like magic to me. It was like coming home, that I can actually do this object instead of the illusion. And learn the art of sculpting. It was beautiful. And from then on, that resonated so deeply within my soul that has been my pursuit my entire life. I went back, I graduated, and have been sculpting full time. It's been exciting to see where these pieces have ended up, because I've come from my passion and been able to express myself. It's been fun to see them go to a Michael Jackson collection or have a 30-foot piece in front of Nu Skin. They've literally gone all over the world, and it's just been extremely rewarding. Viktor Frankl, the author of Man's Search for Meaning and a Holocaust Survivor, he firmly believed that if we don't act responsibly with our freedoms, we will lose those. And now we're able to create his vision. His vision was to create a statue of responsibility. Bookend the Statue of Liberty on the East Coast with a statue of responsibility on the West Coast. It's really exciting to look back and realize the connections that have happened to create the Statue of Responsibility. Kevin Hall, who trained Stephen Covey's people for 20 years, comes to me and says, "Gary, would you design the Statue of Responsibility?" And we end up flying to Vienna, Austria in 2004 and meeting Mrs. Frankl. And she was the one that said, "Gary, come here, I want to show you Viktor Frankl's study and I want to show you his favorite sculpture." I had no idea at the time that he even liked sculpture. We go into his library and there's a special niche that he had created right in the middle of all of these books. And it was a sculpture that she brought down and handed to me. It was called The Suffering Man. And it was a bust, a wooden carving painted of a man reaching up. And she said he used that as a metaphor for responsibility and that we're connected. And she said he would always ask the question, "Where's the hand reaching down? You bring to me a sculpture that answers my husband's question of this statue of responsibility." Someday we're going to be on top of this 300-foot monument. We're going to be up there dancing around and going, "Wow, life and the experiences in that," and being able to just celebrate and go, "You know what? It was all worth it. It was all beautiful. Yeah, the trials and all those things happened, but we did something with it, and we crafted that, and we molded it, and we worked with it, and we did things that lift and inspire and help the entire planet, each and every one of us, individually and collectively." Somehow I was able to go down in there and pull these things out, express myself, able to get this stuff out through the tools that I had been gifted with. I've been able to draw and paint. We are all creators. Man, I look back on my life and I think of all of the things that have happened, all the tragedies, all the great things. You know, it's been up and down, and things happen to every one of us. But I look at it and I think, okay, there's been some challenges and trials, but there's also been all those times when I've decided, okay, I'm gonna do something with this. I'm gonna take these things, and I'm gonna make something good out of it. I'm gonna create and mold good things, great things that inspire and lift others. And then to realize how it's all come to this beautiful climax, this beautiful, pivotal, unbelievable opportunity to create something that is literally going to lift and inspire the planet. Every day we make decisions. We can think about what defines us. Is it our past, or is it where we're going? Is it what we want to do, or what's happened to us? We have the ability. We decide what we're going to create each and every day.